Okay, so looking at worksheet two, let's just remind ourselves right here on the page, how do we find critical numbers, or where are the critical numbers? Do you remember? It's been a week and a half. It has something to do with the first derivative. F prime is zero, or F prime, there's one other thing it could be, undefined. Increasing, that would be where F prime is. What would F prime need to be for a function to be increasing? F prime is the slope. So if F prime is positive, then F is increasing. Like those two things go together. Decreasing would be just the opposite. If F prime is negative, that means the function is decreasing. So that's basically the notes from Friday. Critical numbers increasing and decreasing. So let's do a few to kind of refresh that. And relative extrema, not to give away the punchline for later today, but if you go from increasing to decreasing, you've got a max. And if you go from decreasing to increasing, you've got a min. Like that's the summary of today's lesson right there. All right, but let's back up and review some of this stuff. Number one, the function f is defined by this thing. What are the critical values? So critical values would be where f prime is zero or undefined. Now, that's just a nice polynomial, so I don't think it's going to have any undefined places. But let's take a derivative, set it equal to zero, and that will tell us our critical values. So f prime, 6x squared, minus x, minus 2. And then we'll set that equal to zero to get the critical numbers. It's nowhere undefined. Like, it's defined everywhere, so I don't have to worry about the undefined part. This looks like a factoring problem, especially when I look at my answers. In fact, all my answers are thirds and halves, so I'm pretty sure it's going to be 3x and 2x. And then it's just a matter of figuring out who else goes in there. The 1 and the 2. Let's see. I think I need a 1 there and a 2 there. We're doing this in Algebra 2 right now, factoring. So that would be 4x and 3x can make me a negative x if the 4 is negative and the 3 is positive. Factoring review here. So x equals 2/3 and negative 1/2. Those are the places that make the first derivative 0, so those are critical numbers. So positive 2/3 and negative 1/2. And those are potential maxes and mins. We don't really know yet which one they are or how to figure that out, but if f prime is 0, then slope is 0, so we might have a max or a min at those spots. Number 3, how many, so I don't have to find them, well, I guess I sort of have to find them. How many critical points does that function have? And that's terrible, because now I've got to take a derivative of this thing. I'm thinking product rule here. So first times derivative of the second would be x plus 2 to the fifth. Derivative of the second would be 4x minus 3 cubed. I guess I should think about the chain rule, but the derivative of x minus 3 would just be 1, so that doesn't really add anything. Plus the other way around, so the second, x minus 3 to the fourth, times the derivative of the first, 5 times x plus 2 to the 4th times 1, if we want to be really specific about the chain rule. Okay, so I set that equal to 0. That doesn't do me a whole lot yet. I can factor out a whole bunch of x plus 2s. How many x plus 2s can I take out of those things? 4 of them. X plus 2 to the 4th. I need to be super careful because that leaves one of them on the first term and none of them on the second term. How about x minus 3s? How many of those can I grab? 3. So x minus 3 to the 3rd. And then let's be super careful about what's left. So on the first term, I took all of the x minus 3s, but that leaves a 4 and an x plus 2. On the second term, I took all the x plus 2s, that leaves a 5 and one of the x minus 3s. Okay, now I've got this thing factored. Now can you tell how many critical points that thing has? So this would give me one, x equals negative 2. This would give me another one, x equals 3. And I don't even need to find this one. It's going to be one more, though, because it's going to be, what, 9x something, x equals something. You know what? I guess I better find it in case it's a repeat of one of those. So 9x, 8 minus 15 is minus 7. So again, it doesn't really matter what it is. It's different than the other two. So there's 3 separate critical points. Yuck. Just because the derivative was terrible. And then the algebra was terrible because we had to factor out some stuff. So a couple of review points on that question. Critical points, f prime equals 0. To find f prime, we had to use the product rule, and then we had a whole bunch of algebra after that. Number 5. If g is the function given by that thing, which kind of looks ugly with the fractions, but maybe when we take a derivative it gets easier. On which of the following is g decreasing? So what am I looking for to know where g is decreasing? What's negative? G prime is negative. Those mean the same thing. If g prime is negative, g is decreasing. If g is decreasing, g prime is negative. So I can't look at that and tell much of anything, but if I take a derivative, then I can figure out where the derivative is negative. And let's see, it looks like they've done us a small favor here. The derivative of 1/3 x cubed would be x squared. The derivative of 3/2 x squared would be 3x, and then minus 70, and then the 5 would go away. So that wasn't, like, the derivative was nicer than the original. They kind of rigged the problem for us. I still want to know where that's negative now. I don't know where it's negative, but I can figure out where it's 0. And even if you weren't sure about how to factor it, you look at your answers, and you're like, oh, look, there's a whole bunch of 10s and 7s, because 10 times 7 is 70. And if I do plus 10 and a minus 7, that'll make negative 70, and it'll make 3x in the middle. So those are my critical points. It's not really what I wanted to find. At least that's not the end goal of this problem. Those are the critical points. Those are where the derivative is 0. Do you remember what we do with those next to figure out where G prime is negative. I know where G prime is zero. Let's do a number line. And we'll check the places in between. Or we'll check those intervals. So we'll definitely check zero. That would be an easy thing to check. Probably check 8. And check negative 11. And when we say check, we want to check them into G prime. Probably want to check them into the factored form, because that would make life easier anyway. So if I plug in negative 11, I get negative 1 times negative 18. Which is positive. Again, I don't really care about the number, I only care about the sign. Which is why I like to do the factored form. I don't have to worry about the squaring and 70. I just worry about multiplying. So that would mean G is increasing if G prime is positive. If I check 0, I'm going to get 10 times negative 7. Negative. So G prime is negative means G is decreasing. And then they almost always alternate, so if like you're in a rush, you could just assume that this one's going to be positive. The only time they would not alternate is if you had a double root over here. So again, most of the time students start, I don't want to say cheating, it's shortcutting and being careful. Sometimes even just checking one and alternating off of there. Probably safer to check both. Now you feel like you got the hang of this. Pretty sure this is going to be positive. If I plug in 8, I get 18 times 1. That's positive. So that if G prime is positive, G is increasing. Let's see, what was I asked for? Decreasing would be from negative 10 to 7. Answer choice D. Okay, what we reviewed there was decreasing means G prime is negative. But to figure out where G prime was negative, we figured out where it was zero, we put those on the number line, we tested the intervals, continuing with this connection between G is decreasing, G prime is negative, to figure out where we were decreasing. All right, last one I want to do is number 8. Again, now it's crazy because it's all out of order. Let f be the function given by this thing. Uh-oh. What rule am I thinking even before I read the rest of this problem? Quotient rule. For what values of k is f strictly decreasing? Okay, if f is decreasing, what does that mean? Especially when we're thinking derivatives. F prime is negative. So I can't really tell looking at that original if we're increasing or decreasing. Hopefully I can take a derivative and figure out where the derivative is negative. You need this page? Number 8 on worksheet 2, wherever that might be. Let f be this function, k is constant. Okay, so we're going to take a derivative, figure out where the, or what value of k would make that derivative negative. So top, bottom, so f prime, let's start getting some help here. You're back in the swing of things now. So if f is equal to k times x, then Avery, what is f prime equal to? The other one, k. Because the derivative of x is 1, k is just a constant out front. Ambria, how about the derivative of x squared plus 1? 2x. Okay, so quotient rule now would be gf prime gf prime k times x squared plus 1 minus fg prime, so that would be all those things put together, 2k x squared all over bottom squared. Want to know, or I want to figure out what value of k would make that negative. Well, kind of like the last one, like I don't really want to worry about negatives first. Let's worry about zeros first, and then we'll figure out negatives after that. So the top would be, let's see, kx squared plus k minus 2kx squared. I'm going to leave the bottom alone because it doesn't have any k's. It's also always positive. So it's a quotient rule, but I'm going to be able to ignore the denominator. So that's at least one small nice thing. So k minus kx squared. I'm going to factor out the k. 1 minus x squared. Bottom doesn't really matter. So for what values of k is f strictly decreasing?
Between negative 1 and 1.
Okay. So the bottom is always positive, right? If I square anything, add 1 and then square that, that's always going to be positive. So I'm not worried about the denominator.
Now, what about 1 minus x squared between negative 1 and 1? If I do 1 minus x squared, but my x's are all between negative 1 and 1, can you figure out what this is going to be?
If I plug in a half, or 0, or negative 1 half, that's always going to be positive. So, if I've got k times positive over positive, and I want this to be negative, it's a lot of thinking, but not a lot of math, really, I guess. If k is negative, then this whole thing would be negative. So if k is less than 0, then everything will be negative. That's a hard one. That's why I wanted to work that one. The algebra was hard. The calculus wasn't too bad. There was a quotient rule, and we again had to know that decreasing means that f prime is negative. Okay, so before we go on the notes, recap the notes from Friday. Critical numbers, f prime is 0 or undefined. Increasing means f prime is positive. Decreasing means f prime is negative. So, like, concept-wise, not bad. In practice, could be really hard depending on how bad or how ugly the functions are.